Right, 2 p.m. past 1 minute, at least in my time zone. I guess it's 12 past 1 in UTC. And so we will start. Hello, everybody. Thanks for being here and for coming. I am Dario. I work for SUSE in the virtualization team. But I'm not going to talk about virtualization, not that much today. I'm going to talk about whether or not macOS can already be your daily driver, or whether or not it is being mine. And is it being mine? Well, it is. It is, you can see here from this very ugly screenshot of the output of the ATC OS release file. It's a screenshot, so it can be fake, sure. I can show you live at the end of the session if there is time, because of course this is the machine from which I am giving the presentation. After all, I am saying this, my daily driver wouldn't be so if I weren't doing that. And I don't like that much introductory slides. I have one with info about myself at the end if anyone is interested. But I guess I have to do at least a little bit about what I do, because that's interesting in this, the context of this, presentation, sorry, because it's the thing that I do on macOS desktop. And well, it's nothing really fancy there. I am a developer in the virtualization team, so I do read and send a lot of emails. I write, build, and test code in the project that I'm active on, which are hypervisors and virtualization tool stack. I do work with the open build service for packages and stuff, and then the usual browsing, meetings, video calls, chats, occasionally some gaming, but not that much multimedia things. And do I do all these things with macOS? Yes, and I will try to show you how, with some tweaks, but that's the point of this presentation. And this, yeah, so what is macOS? I have put the material here, well, not sure even if I'm calling it material, links mostly, links to wiki pages, to documentation, to official websites, and to talks. There have been quite a few talks already, even at this event, but also at previous events, previous Open SUSE conference and other events. So yeah, I'm going to assume that you were yesterday at Richard's talks, and I'm not going to cover that much details about what macOS is. And even about what macOS as a desktop is, well, same, because yesterday's Richard talk was really about macOS as a desktop. What it is, why it is, what's the way forward, and he covered very well this part. So the video is already available. Watch it, or watch any other of the ones that are linked here, because I say there are quite a few many. It's our OpenSUSE single purpose immutable operating system, and it does one thing. One of the things that you can do could be your desktop. That's all I'm going to say about it. I myself got involved in the project during Hackweek. Hackweek 19, which happened in 2020, we have to do something with this thing. It's terrible that 1920, then 2021. Well, anyway, it's basically the week of the year where SUSE employees can do whatever they found cool. And I did find cool Richard's project about trying out macOS as a desktop. Back then, I mainly started testing it. Not that much of a packager myself, so that was the best thing that I could do at the time. And I started hacking a little bit on Toolbox, which is a tool that at least I find very, very handy. It's absolutely instrumental for macOS being my daily desktop driver right now. So I will talk a little bit about it later. Why I try and what I like it in it. This is also something that Richard covered, but especially considering that I've seen yesterday that there were a few questions, I guess, a few words if I have time. It's relatively small. I say relatively small because, as we said, it doesn't have to be small at all costs, and nothing like that. But if you compare it, I have some stats at the end, if you compare it with, for example, a basic tumbleweed installation, it has fewer RPM packages, at least. That's in what sense I call it small. And most of everything, yeah, it's immutable, so it's reliable. It uses all, it exploits the characteristic of BTRFS to their maximum in order to implement the updates that don't disturb the running system and all these things. It has been said, for example, yesterday that we have OpenQA for Tumbleweed. Tumbleweed is pretty solid, and it is. It has been for me until I use it. What I like of this approach of using MicroS, for example, instead, is that, we have fewer RPM packages. It means fewer dependencies, fewer potential problems with dependencies such as an update of a package break dependency for something, and so you are not able to install another version or upgrade an existing version of another package that you have. And also, yes, we do have OpenQA, of course, which is great. It's probably one of the reasons, it's not the reason why, for example, Tumbleweed is so rock solid. But after all, if you think about it, we are, I mean, not many of us, I think, use the Tumbleweed that comes out of OpenQA, because, for example, we add external repos. Maybe I should turn off my camera, I surely can. And so I was saying, because we may have external repos, an official one, but even if we only have Pacman, which we all know that it's usually more than fine, but then it's not what's really being tested and that we know that works when OpenQA is green. While on the other hand, in the case of MicroS, at least for me for now, it is. I'm not even using Pacman, for example. I don't need. So it's even more rock solid if you want. Right, installing it, just do it. There's not much that I can say about it. It's a standard MicroS install. If you want to install it as a desktop, just pick the flavor. And even if you have not installed MicroS yet or Kubik yet, it's a pretty close to a standard portable with install. Immediately after install, you do these things. Now, presented like that, it looks like a little bit of black magic, I understand, but I'm going to leave it like that, not because it's really black magic, but mostly because these are things that the installer should really do, or some configuration happening right after installation, I don't know and don't care, should really do automatically. You shouldn't have to do them manually. We just are not there yet, and so we have to do them manually. They are mostly about making sure enabling Flat Hub as a Flatpak remote repository, and making sure that when you use GNOME software, you use it for downloading Flatpaks. So that's what they do. And after you have done this one here, remember to reboot. Some more post-install customization. If you want to use toolbox from your user, which again we will cover later, you have to do also these things, which probably is something that I would think we should also do automatically, but we'll see. Then, for example, this is entirely personal. I like my user to have sudo working without password, and so I do it. And for now, this is not something that I like to, I don't know whether this will be, how this will be in the long run, because automatically installing and rebooting is a feature which is great of MicroS, and I deeply like it. I'm not sure how it will work for desktops. We have to, we have to think whether or no it can work, and if yes, we have to come up with a sane policy for when installing and rebooting, on how to make the user aware and able to decide and to control this thing. So for now, I rebooted it because I don't want my system to rebooted itself whenever I'm in the middle of something, and I will deal with updating it manually, just as I do with Tumbleweed, for example. Now, usually this is the point where you add a lot of external repositories, the Pacman, but not limited to Pacman, and you install a lot of RPM packages because you want to do a lot of different things with your distribution. And you can do that on macOS, can't you? You can, but you really shouldn't. First of all, yes, you can install packages, but you don't use Zipper. You can try, it's there, but it doesn't work. By design, it's on purpose. This one at least is not a bug or something that you need to fix. You have to use this other tool called transactional update, and you have to use this in this way. So invoking it with the syntax pkg install, or invoking a shell in which you can use Zipper, or you can continue updating the snapshot, it's complicated, read the manual. But what I want you to notice is that, there are a few ways for which you use it, but after having used it, you reboot. And if you don't reboot, you don't have available the software, the packages that you have installed. So you reboot after each and every package installation or removal, which might make you think that we reboot a lot. And a little bit in the beginning of, I mean, right after the installation, but it's really, believe me, only because we are in this stage, this alpha stage, let's say, where there are a few things that needs to be manually tweaked. Because once you are past that phase, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen to me at all. For example, yeah, there is an instance of the uptime where the uptime in the system was 3 days and 16 hours, but I have reached even higher peaks without having to reboot. Don't I need to install a thing or applications or how do I do all the things that I showed you before without installing or removing any package for 3 days? I do that by using Flatpak for App and using that cool tool called Toolbox. And really, installing and removing RPMs tends to zero. Flatpak, another thing about it, I'm not going to say much, just this bundle for format of bundled application that you can install on every distribution, and of course you can install them on OpenSUSE macOS. We have configured it at the beginning. We just fetch the stuff and install them, search for the Flatpak that you need and install them. These are screenshots of what I have installed here. Is one of what I have running at this point, which Flatpak. And Toolbox is the other tool. Toolbox is a shell script, which makes it very easy and handy to launch a Podman container, a privileged Podman container. You can launch a privileged Podman container that runs as root on the host, or you can launch a privileged Podman container that runs as your regular user on the host, thanks to rootless Podman, which we also have configured at the beginning of the presentation, right after the installation. Inside Toolbox, depending on the way you choose to use it, you will always have access to the root file system of the host. Depending on which way you use it, you will have your file in different locations, but I'll show you. I want to stress just a little bit that I said privileged container that can be run as root, so it's not a security enhancing tool. Please don't use it with the mindset like I'm doing everything in a container, so nothing can hurt me or my system. It's not like that. It's not the purpose for which we are using it. We are using it because it's really convenient in such a setup. You're, of course, not less safe and secure than when you do these things on the host on a regular Tumbleweed distribution, but you are not necessarily more secure than that. So, as I said, different kind of toolboxes. Basically, toolbox, as I said, can run as your user on the host, which happens if, for example, you just type toolbox in a shell and you end up inside the toolbox, inside the container, you end up being root there, but you are root in the toolbox. That root user in the toolbox does not map to root on the host. And you don't have your user in this case inside the toolbox. You have the data, but they are mind mounted in a different locations, not under home and name of your user. If on the other end you use this option here dash u and even maybe dash t and give it a name, so you can have more than a toolbox because you can tag it and have more than one. Then in this case, you are still running the toolbox as your user, like below, but you also have your user inside the toolbox, and you have your data in your own directory, and you have a lot of stuff that makes it convenient for use. They are both relevant use cases and valid use cases, depending on what you want to do with it. I have examples later. And then the same, but with this dash r parameter added to the invocation of toolbox, which means that in this case, toolbox run as root in your system. So if you use the dash r parameter, then when you become root in the toolbox, this maps to the root user on the host. And when I say map, I mean, for example, permission of accessing privileged resources or to see and touch the files that in the host file system are owned by the real root user. I'll show you an example. Last thing that I want to say before doing that is that another cool thing about toolbox is that it's stateful. So it stays, you create your toolboxes and they stay the way that, not the way that you created, the way that you created and then how you modified them for your purposes. So you create one today, then you turn off the PC for a week, and then when you come back, the toolbox it doesn't start from scratch. It's in the same state as back as before. And here it is. You check what toolbox do you have, and you interact with them. Examples. Let's say that let's say that you have to debug something with strays, and you are on your macOS desktop, you don't have strays installed, so you have to install it with transactional update and reboot, but you don't want to do that. So what do? You enter in a toolbox, you install the tool there, because Zipper works inside a toolbox, the file system of the toolbox is not read-only, and then you can do your debugging or whatever you want. Similarly, you want to scan the ports of some host in your LAN, and you don't have Nmap installed on your base operating system. So what do? You enter in a toolbox. You need, this is an, one use case where you need the dash R because you need privileges to access the lower ports for scanning. And then you install the tool there and do whatever you want, without having to install the package in the base system and rebooting. Now, toolbox is configurable. You can configure the base name of the toolboxes of the container. You can configure the image, which is the default one is this one, based on Tumbleweed and customized to be perfect as a toolbox for debugging and everything. But in theory, if you change this, you can have a toolbox out of plain Tumbleweed, out of Leap, or even out of another distribution, which kind of works, but I'm still working on making it a little bit better. But it will work at some point, at least in my plans. Oh, toolbox. If you use toolbox dash u toolbox, that's the typo. Sorry. You can even launch graphical applications, which you install in the toolbox, and then they work perfectly on the like they were on the host. And you can see here, for example, the fonts and icon works perfectly. Not really, but now they do after installing also these packages inside the toolbox. So, yeah, do it if you need it. I'm wondering whether this means that we have some dependency problems. I need to think and check this a little bit better. But anyway, after having done that, it works. And this is another example, another graphical application that I wanted to use. I didn't want to install it on the host because there's no need of doing that. But it wants to, it's not only a graphical application, it wants to draw stuff via OpenGL. And it didn't work. I was only getting a black window. I have the NVIDIA proprietary driver installed on this workstation. So I thought, what about if I do something like that? I add the NVIDIA repository on the inside the toolbox. I installed this package, the NVIDIA drivers in the toolbox, which ends up pulling in kernel default devel, the KMP, inside a container. It will never work, I thought, when I was trying. Well, it did. So, yeah, you can use graphical apps from Toolbox, which is very, very useful and handy. Now, remember this list? I say that I do these things with this computer where I have Micro S as my desktop. Most of them are easily doable by just installing the Flatpak from FlatHub of the relevant application that achieves that job. So, for example, I use Evolution, I use like LibreOffice. If I want, I use these chat tools, and you just install them and use them. I have a list. I'm not going to read it; it's pointless. But you have it here just as an example. And browsing is a little bit special. There is a very nice Flatpak for Firefox, which I use. There is nothing for Chrome or Chromium, although something is being worked on. One caveat is that if you want to install GNOME Shell extensions, which I do a little bit, not many, but I used a few of them, then I wasn't able to install them from inside any browser which was running in a Flatpak, so neither Firefox nor Epiphany or GNOME Web. I was able to do it if I install a browser in the base OS, and so I did it. I use Chrome, and I deviated from the philosophy and everything. I don't know whether it's not possible, just not possible. It won't ever be possible to do that, or if there is just need to tweak something, add some permissions, or implement some portals. We will have to see. For now, I use this as a workaround. And gaming. I say that I don't do that much of that, but a little bit. And Steam works perfectly fine. There is a question saying, how do you install the base OS if Zipper is locked? You do it with transactional update. So it's one of those exceptions where I did, I have a blog post and there is a link in the slide where I have exact commands for example, installing Chrome, but it's here. So you do, for example, sudo transactional update shell. You add the repository of Google Chrome, you install Zipper in Google Chrome, then you exit and reboot. And you're done. As I said, it's an example. It's really one of the few examples. It's something that I had to do in this case. Yeah, and even multimedia works. And as I said, I don't even need to add Pacman as an external repository. I'm not installing Codex on the base OS. I'm just using VLC and all the other things, including Firefox. The Firefox Flatpak has the codecs too, so I really don't need it either. Now, yes, printing works. I sent a service request, an OBS request for that earlier in the week. It wasn't before because we weren't installing caps and no printer drivers. We do now as a part of the default installation, so you will find something there and hopefully your printer will work. Otherwise, we'll install whatever driver you need with transactional update and perhaps let us know so we will add it, because I think that printing should probably work out of the box, so we are happy to think about it. Scanning doesn't really yet work, but I have to look into that. Well, most of these scanners, at least my, have a web interface, so it's not my top priority, to be honest, for now. But yeah, in general, it should also work. So we have gone through almost the entire list, apart from the development stuff, which I really want to cover, so I will quickly go there. So, for example, I work on QEMU, and I want to build QEMU because I did some change and I want to build test it, and I have to install these packages as dependency. So I guess you have learned at this point then that I am not going to do what I said before for Chrome. I'm not going to install them with transaction update and then reboot, because I don't want to do that. Because then I realized that there is one dependency missed, that I forgot, and I have to do it again because upstream had a dependency and I have to do it again. It's not funny. It's really not funny. So what do? I enter a toolbox, a user toolbox, which I tag as my development toolbox so that I can fetch it back later. And I do all my development inside it. And I edit the changes and I build them and everything. Working with OBS, same. Needs to be a toolbox which you start with -r because it has to mount some of special file system inside the building VM when you do OSC build. But really, same. I enter the toolbox, I do all the usual OBS workflow, and even build locally and commit. And here you see that there was the QEMU processes from the VM, which was building my packages. This is another example. It's a little bit complicated. It sounds a little bit complicated, but it's really not. So as I said, I work on virtualization. So I work on the virt, QEMU, and the kernel. It may happen that I make changes to the kernel, to QEMU, to the virt, and I want to, of course, build them and test the results of this build with these changes. So what do? It's very similar to what I said already. I enter my development toolbox and I do all my changes. Then, still in that development toolbox, for example, I can start libvirt. My modified version of libvirt, I make it listed to the TCP socket, to the TCP port instead of using socket activation. And then either in the same or in another toolbox, I can just connect to it. And so I am running and using the libvirt that I modified, which is perhaps using the QEMU that I modified, which is perhaps running a VM, which is using the kernel that I modified. And so I can do all my development and testing of my stuff like this. And yes, this is a picture of a screenshot of libvirt running in the dev toolbox, virt manager running in another toolbox, connecting to this libvirt here, and then starting this VM, which runs my modified kernel. And this is all inside various toolboxes without having installed anything in the base operating system. So yeah. I use Toolbox heavily. As I said, it's the first tool that I started hacking on as my contribution on this project, and I made it so that it can be used, at least for me, in this way. So that basically my day work-wise, at least, entirely, I spend it entirely inside a toolbox in which I can run Tmux, so I don't even have to start toolbox multiple times in multiple terminals, and I never left the toolbox and the Tmux session until it's the time to stop. And just last thing I want to say, some very unreliable and crude and meaningless probably stats. Currently on my base OS, I have around 1,000 packages, but I did some experiments, so it's not really what you get. It's a little bit more than what you get at the beginning, but then there is something missing, so yeah. In my development toolbox, I have quite a few more called the development dependencies, so I have 1,300, but then on a tumbleweed that I don't even use any longer for development, I have much more than that. And if you try Fedora Silver Blue and you check right after install, you have around 1,200 binaries.
Could we have people behind you? So
yes, exactly. I'm done. Just
wrap it up, please.
Yeah, absolutely. And just one word about Flatpaks are heavy and duplicate a lot of stuff. It's certainly true, but after all, I have around 70 applications and their runtimes, and that takes roughly a little bit more than 10 gigabytes, so not really so much. And that's it. This I can skip. And as a conclusion, yes, I'm using it. There is some feeding necessary, but to be honest, not too much. If you are interested, ask. If you are really interested, help. That's it. Sorry if I used pretty much of the time, so I'm not sure whether it is time for questions. But I'm available here for the rest of the day, or can be contacted with the various means, email and everything.
Thank you. Appreciate it. If you want to talk with Dario, I mean, you probably could go into the other chat room. There's things available like that here.
Sure. So. And thanks.
Thank you.